I appreciate you being here, and thank you very much for having me. Yes, I don't sound like a Kiwi, and that is because I'm going to become one. But the sandbox of play. I invented almost 120 patents, and my very first one that I did happened in a sandbox. And I thought to myself, the only way that I can do this and create and be an inventor is to have magic eyes. Now, I want you all to do this with me, please. This is magic eyes. Thank you. Do you see everything different now? Can you see clearly how creative and realities come together? With those magic eyes, I could see so much and invent a great deal. Typical sandbox, typical castles. And then I discovered there were jewels inside. And if I went in my magic sandbox, there were so many things I could build, so much that I could do, places that I could go. It was unreal what there was, including major coasters and theme parks. I was 7 years old. And ever since that first invention, I never stopped. And that was because I love to play. And play in itself, including one of these fantastic inventions. Do you guys know what I mean? Do you know how fabulous a box is? You might get gifts for people, but this by far is one of the best there is in the world. When I discovered this, there are so many places I could go, so many places I could fly to. I'm so glad I wore this today. I starred in so many television series, and I actually believe that one of the most important things about a box is it can become anything. It is the heart of invention. I truly do believe there's magic inside here. Well, now I'm inside here, but magic, that's actually a cool thing. I could be magic. I can make this happen. And the key to success of seeing the box as a place to invent literally took me in places I never thought I could go. And one of those places, look at this. It's magical. It's a castle. Have you ever been in a box where it's become a castle? I know. I've been there. I've been to space, too. And then as I realized that sand and boxes and everything could be my ultimate platform, my parents at 10 years old took me to Daytona Beach. The coolest thing about going here is that I knew that this no longer would work, that I had to get one of these, because that's a big sandbox. And realizing how big ideas could be, how much you could do with just the idea of your imagination and play would be one of those things that the world could be big enough for me to play in. Now, being in a big world like this, I love this world, isn't that huge? I decided, even as I grew up, that I would never lose my magic eyes, and today I still have them. Now, that doesn't really work if you play out of the box and you don't have a formal beginning. So what I decided to do is become a psychologist. I started signing and learning and communicating with deaf children and their families. I used play as a way to get through to them, communication, and figuring out how to work with kids who weren't able to communicate using a verbal means. That taught me a lot. That's one little section of invention that I truly love. I wrote books on play, and I offered parents my skill sets. So instead of the kids coming into my office and then me helping them with their problems, I would help the parents solve them for themselves. That just didn't seem like it could get global enough. And one thing that I knew for sure is how could I get to solving problems before they became them? So why not create things that support joy and play in bigger ways? So I decided I'd build theme parks. And now I have over 400 of these. Has anyone ever seen these? Ever been in one of the water parks where you see these big dumping buckets? One of the early inventions was to figure out how to get people to play together shooting water, large, extreme water dumping on top of them in a communal, fun way. Ugh. It was brilliant to be able to work with a team of inventors and support that kind of ingenious play. Then I went to foam balls, like 10,000 of them, in a massive shooting arena where the balls were flying everywhere, they were dumping all over your head, and people were having a great time. Their sound. There it is. That was 25 years ago. Oh, now actually 30 years ago. And the growing idea of bringing theme park play and the use of invention to do that still became from my spirit of seeing things with magic eyes. I had to look at it as an inventor and create in a way that took the idea of shooting Nerf guns into a whole different arena. That invention, believe me, takes a lot of technology, but it also had to do with the way I thought, how I brought that forward. And I am appealing to you to think like this, big, like a big sandbox, and figure out how you can bring your creative ideas to a larger scope. And think like an inventor, because there's a little bit of a difference. The idea of being creative and having big blue sky ideas is slightly changed when you see yourself as an inventor. And that is because invention makes it happen. You have to create teams and people to elevate it to the next level. And invention is actually an awesome thing. You know, you're sitting on the plane with somebody and they ask you, what do you do? I'm an inventor versus I'm a creative. It takes it to another level. Like, what did you invent? Not necessarily, why are you creative? So if you see yourself in that process, it's a different kind of magic eyes inward. The next thing that I did was I decided that I wanted to take video games and make them come to life. So using an RFID tracking, I was able to make a large-scale game using those same foam balls and a large system that tracked the player all through the experience. There was a big scoreboard, and you as a master farmer were able to collect and retrieve your points. At the end, we had to take the wristbands back. This is, again, like 25 years ago, and that technology, now Magic Band and things like that in major theme parks, was the first of its kind, and it was a little bit of expensive. But the kids didn't want to lose their points. They wanted to keep their bands. And I thought, there's an idea there. So I decided that the most important thing that I liked about my box and my sandbox was to be able to create castles. So in the year 2001, I started working on an idea called Magic Quest. It was about using a very specific thing that I always liked playing with, a magic wand. Now, this magic wand really works. It's got technology inside of it, and when you wave it, it makes all these special effects happen. In this large-scale experience, you become the avatar, the game hero, in a life-size quest and adventure series, and we never forget you. This is one of my first wands from 15 years ago. And the moment I wave it, it knows that I am the purple enchantress and that I have some gazillion points now at level Master Magi level. That magic wand actually can be changed and customized. So it's basically starting with a toy and then going to play in a game. And I'm going to show you, talk about the invention of that happening. But literally, you were able to battle dragons, earn different powers, and succeed in the same thing that you could do behind a screen, now live with family and friends. Remember my goals when I was a therapist about bringing people together through play and experiences like this? It's still part of my everyday vision of what I want to do as an inventor. The next thing I tackled were water park slides. Same old slide, you go up, you go down. But in this case, you would actually have buttons on the handle. You would go down and see the lights. You had to press the button at the right time, this guitar hero in a water park slide. And then you would have a score at the end that you could keep on an app, continue to play the game on the mobile device, and then go back to the park and have both of your scores mutually added together. Again, taking a physical experience, adding some technology, whiz and game, and was able to do a physical experience with families. There's about 18 of them now. I love this big world, and I love flying around it. In all the places that I have been, I finally got here. And one of the most important things about being here was to meet Weta Workshop and start using the medium of story world building as a part of my creative collaborative. I love it. It's incredible to think that you can bring those brilliant creative minds together and start thinking about making live experiences and real life stories. I'm very grateful to be a part of that organization. But this is where I'm most excited. I'm part of Edmund Hillary Fellowship, and that's about bringing global change to the world through and to and all over, and thinking about business and support and invention in a globally good way. I'll show you more on that in a second. I'm going to take you through Magic Quest really quickly. Oh, I'm doing so good for time. Yay for me. So Magic Quest, I'm going to show you an invention process. And we're going to go through it in a way that when I'm done, I hope all of you come up to me and ask me how you can invent too. So please come bother me and see if any of this resonates about how you bring an invention or idea to life. It started with this idea, the idea that I saw kids being enveloped in technology. Now, as a mom, I have three kids. One of the thinking models that I had was, what's going to happen to this next generation so absorbed in technology, really able, not just adopters, but innate going through them? Will they lose their play? And at the time, I was working on video games, and I was also working at Hasbro. I was given this, which is Play School Puzzle CD. This is 2000. And what happened when I saw that is my then three-year-old daughter got obsessed with it when I put it on the computer and the games began. This she no longer did. This was much more attractive. And so the Magic Quest idea came from the idea that what I really need to do is think about the tangible and the technical together. And what I like so much about AR, authentic reality, is this physicalness of the game, the physicalness of an invention of people all playing together, was just as good as that video game that you would play on the screen. So the architecture of gaming isn't what's wrong. To me, it was losing that play value, that physical essence. So when you collide those things together, it really is a collaborative invention. That I call techno magic. And when I think about techno magic, this is one of my most favorite moments of techno magic. Do you guys know what I'm talking about? He created the Wizard of Oz. Don't look behind the curtain. What's so fantastic is that believable world that was created, but it wasn't about technology. It was about bringing them together, remembering home. All of that was created with illusion and magic. The technology is all there. But the moment somebody doesn't think this is a magic wand, I've lost. But that's not what happened. I'm very lucky with all the different things that I was able to bring with magic wands and magic keys, which all track you in the game, these physical items that have game and quest and adventure, was truly this large-scale video game come to life. Same thing on the screen, but now in your hands. And what I loved about doing this was the excitement they would have when these large screen goblins would come to life and they had to battle them in real life. But my favorite moment, whoops, gonna go back. Am I going back? Hello, gents, can you help me out a bit? All right. Oh, no. Where do we go? I guess we're gonna watch this first. That'll do.
Thank you. was close.
No kidding. Very powerful spells.
So that technology and the support around it allowed me to keep advancing and thinking through how I would do this in the next phase. So that's 15 years ago. And now I'm working on a technology in which I still think that we're in that screen stage where there's too much time spent on that screen. This is a secret project that's going on now, where we basically are looking at all kinds of new technology behind the curtain that makes it feel different and unique. Now, in this case, when you would wave the wand, the goblin would come out and you would have to interact with it. Now you're going to meet your other you behind the screen in another universe. That other you is there to help you, but you can't jump into that screen. So you only have a little bit of screen time. Just that one moment where you say, I need a key from your land, and I'll have to get the lock over on this side. Okay, go. And then you separate, and that world exists on its own, and then the new world exists in real life. Therefore, the interaction on the screen is minimal. That, to me, is the next evolution of gaming. You know how you have to control the avatar when you're in a game? In this case, you let it go, and you have to do things in the real world. That avatar might be upstairs, but it's going to help you out and give you the key somewhere downstairs. So if you're going throughout the entire building, you have to go to two different places that's not on the same screen. Retro-forwarding. Magic Quest was able to combine both the magic of that box that I used to think of when I was a little girl with the ability to wave wands and make it come together. But it also brought in lots of adults. Do you know that 50% of the players that I had in Magic Quest were adults, moms in particular? This is my favorite moment. When I was at Magic Quest, I would come out and I would watch everybody afterwards as they were leaving. And there was this guy that was playing in there full sweat, like totally going through all the quests and adventures. He stepped out of Magic Quest, and he was with his family, and he looked up at that light post, and he waved his wand. It doesn't work. The technology's inside. But for a moment, that's who he thought he was. Do you know how great it is in an invention when that happens, when you're able to actually invent the idea that he believes he's magical? The technology supported it, but his imagination took it in a whole different place. Truly like a box I was able to check off I didn't even know I had. Now I'm going to tell you a little bit about players and pretzels. In this situation, that's the player. Do you know who the pretzeler is? That guy. In all of my inventions, the arm pretzler is my favorite because they're the ones I need to get. If you're going to invent something for all the people that like what you do, you're only going to get a certain percentage of the market. So my inventions are all about this guy. I want him. So what I created was the Book of Wisdom. Essentially, it's the cheat book. I would give it to the adults. They would be able to master the situation. The kids would come to them, and then about 10 minutes in, they buy a wand. That retro ability of using scavenger hunt books gave them the idea, the confidence, and the play permission to join their family. I love the ability to create that kind of gaming where they're involved, it's a part of the system, and the retro forwarding of that, the technology plus going back to something that we remember, like this. This is my grandson. Oh, how so much fun. One of my favorite things as a young child was whoopee cushions. I now have a new device from the Minions. Thank you very much. Is that the best retro forwarding you have ever seen? I literally woke up my intern this morning with the fart alarm clock. What I also mean by this, and I did, I invented a whole character around farts called Snort, who made the world's largest fart in Magic Quest, is that the idea of retro forwarding is this has been around for a long time. The idea that we're smacking people in the heads and putting it on their faces. The next evolution of this is the void, which allows you to move in spaces and socially interact with each other. It's a pretty cool experience, and they've got some pretty powerful brands. I love the idea of having immersive environments like this, but I don't like the idea of closing people off. I love the social aspect of it. So the next invention is anyone wants to work with me on how we're more social with VR, I'm all in. So if the world is a big sandbox, and all of us are sitting in it, and we have the ability to create what we want, I began thinking with my EHF, my Edmund Hillary Fellowship responsibilities, how do I do this in a big way with some of the inventions I clearly already did? Now, look at all that water pouring down. Look at all these amazing tools that I could use that bring in a more forward-thinking way. And I've been working on what is called impact attractions. It's using that same water park knowledge with sitting in the sun with the wind and the earth as our new player and inviting the earth to come play with us. It will be a self-sustainable unit that probably creates more energy than it uses. How great of an invention could that be if we could actually power our theme in water parks that actually give back to the grid? Nice. So that invention is being worked on. Anybody in the sustainability that wants to come jump on board, let me know. Oh, looking more like that, by the way. I got so excited and power it through. Huh? Sneak peek, can show you just a little. Oh, gotta click it through. So, as my part of being in New Zealand, I have also learned to love the energy of Kiwi and Iwi support and how to think about telling a great story. So using the technologies that I have available to me, dome technologies, amazing capture technologies, how can we tell a story about our world in which it isn't doom and gloom? What if we actually do a positive story? Something where we look at saving the world, and we do it, like 30 years from now, like 40 years from now. It's not yuck, it's incredible. Can't we tell that story and make you a part of it? So part of the advanced technology I'm working on now is to have you in an attraction, and we capture your shadow, your foreshadow. And that shadow is then brought into the cinematic expression of us saving the world in the future. And you see how your shadow in that dome, in that 3D, in that amazing surround experience comes to life, making a difference, telling a positive story. What I love so much about New Zealand is your recognition of personhood. But what if the whole world is the person? What if we are actually playing and working and seeing it as our whole, and the whole world makes that commitment as well? So I'm going to leave you with this one thought. Practice the art of being an inventor. See ideas from curation to creation and put your passions into practice. But always see things through your magic eyes. And most importantly, don't ever stop playing or believing in magic. Thank you.